commence our time together as we sing a few choruses just to settle our hearts in the Lord's presence. The first one this morning, as we are gathered, Jesus is here, one with each other, Jesus is here. We'll sing this one twice through. Jesus, keep me near the cross. Someone asked me, Pastor, could we sing this? I said, yes, no problem. Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain, free to all, a healing stream flows from Calvary's mountain.
Free to all, a healing stream.
Now we'll sing this one together. Dear Savior, thou art mine, how sweet the thought to me. And after this one, we'll stand and sing our opening hymn, Christ Triumphant. So, dear Savior, thou art mine. That and you know him as your Savior, that changes everything. Everything about life. He hath said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Death, he died the death for us that we might live eternity. I know thou art mine, and I know one day I'll be with you. Let's stand, sing our opening hymn, Christ Triumphant, Ever Reigning Savior, Master King.
Master King, Lord of them, my life sustains.
Amen. Let's just take a moment quietly as we bow our hearts together before God in prayer. Let's seek His blessing to be upon us this morning. Our God and our Father, we approach your high and holy throne this morning, and we come in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We come to you with praise and with worship. We lift our hearts before you in adoration, for you are a great God and greatly to be praised. You are the God who has created all things out of nothing. You are the God who sustains all things by the word of your power. Our Father, many people look out in our world today and they think the world is collapsing all around them. But as your children, we can say today, God is still on the throne and He will remember His own. Though trials may press us and burdens distress us, He never will leave us alone. So, Father, we come to you knowing with absolute confidence that you sit enthroned upon the universe that you have made. Father, thank you for sending your Son, our blessed Lord Jesus Christ, into the world to be our Savior. Thank you that there on an old rugged cross outside the city walls, the Lord Jesus Christ suffered and bled and died for sinners just like us. They took him from the cross. They buried him. But the grave could not hold him, for up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph o'er his foes. And Father, today we bow before you in the name of the living Christ of God. And those of us who know and love him as our Savior can say with confidence, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. Father, thank you that we come before you in the name of your Son, our Savior, knowing that he's with us today, for he has said that he will never leave us nor forsake us. Father, thank you for your kindness again this week, for blessing us, for helping us, for providing for us, for watching over us as we've traveled on the roads, and for the very desire that you've put within our hearts to be here just now. Again, we give you our thanks. Father, we remember those who would love to be with us, but we recognize some are laid aside, some are elderly and no longer are they able to meet with us, and we commend each one of them to you. But we think of Winston back in hospital again today, and we pray, Father, for Winston, for Muriel, for the family, that God would help them and encourage them in these trying times. For those who are waiting on hospital appointments to go through various tests, we commend them to you and pray, our Father, that you might grant to them in these days the very peace of God that would pass all their understanding. Bless Adam as he speaks with the boys and girls. Bless the men upstairs as they put our services out over the internet. We thank you for those that you have gifted musically to play at our instruments. And we thank you for everyone able to come to this building just now, and for those at home joining us on Facebook Live. Father, we pray that you would bless each one of us. Make this a great day in your presence, a day when your name will be glorified, and a day when the Lord Jesus Christ will be exalted in the midst of his redeemed people. Hear our prayers as we bring them to you now, in the Savior's precious and worthy name. Amen. Amen. Now let me take a moment to make the necessary announcements for today and for the incoming week. First of all, let me welcome all gathered in the building just now and those who are visiting with us, you're all very, very welcome, and a warm welcome too to those who are joining us live on Facebook. We pray that God will bless each one of us at the point of our need. After the ministry of God's word, we meet around the Lord's table, and we do that to remember the Lord Jesus Christ in his own appointed way. If you're saved, walking in fellowship with the Lord, please wait as we break bread together. Ali Lindsay Farrell will be on Children's Church today. Diane Madeley, Yvonne McCrum, Kristen Guinness, and Aaron Bell will be on Christ duty. We meet again tonight, 5:45 for our prayer meeting, 6:30 our gospel meeting, and God willing, I'll be preaching at that service too. There will be a praise group practice after the gospel meeting, and then youth fellowship will commence at 8 o'clock. As I said last week, CEF have recently launched their new journal aimed at children aged 7 to 14, and that's to help them understand the gospel and to be able, as young Christians, to articulate the gospel to others as well, and they can share it, therefore, more confidently. This journal is called Go Tell, and it's to guide and equip Christian children to witness their faith. Now, tonight it's been arranged in the church hall for tomorrow night at 7:30 p.m. with David Crutchley, and he's going to explain the book to us and how we use it. So we're inviting parents, children, youth workers, anyone interested to come along and hear about this new resource. In a number of weeks, the Sunday School and Bible class are going to gift this journal to the age-appropriate children. So we encourage parents as well to attend tomorrow night, if that's possible. Tuesday, 10:30, parents and toddlers. 6:45, the Good News Club. Then 8 o'clock, the ladies' meeting. This will take the form of a visitors' night, and a number of ladies' fellowships have been invited to come. The speaker is Callum Webster from Christian Institute, and he's going to be speaking on this occasion about the ongoing RSE situation in our province. The soloist is Judith Beattie. So please plan to come and encourage as many ladies as possible to come and join with our own ladies. Ladies, please bring sandwiches and tray bakes already plated. Now, we hope to record this meeting, and we're hoping then to set up a meeting. Some of the men have said, well, I'll not be at the ladies' meeting, and I'd like to hear this. So we're going to record the meeting, set up a meeting over in the church hall for those who are interested in hearing about the situation regarding RSE. So we'll keep you up to date about that if we're able to do that. Wednesday night, 8 o'clock, Bible study prayer meeting, exploring Ephesians. And then Friday, 12:15, there'll be no Friday Bible study this week, but 7:30 through to 9:30 will be the youth club. Next Lord's Day, which of course is Remembrance Sunday, 10 o'clock Sunday school Bible class, 11:30 morning service and breaking of bread. Ivan McCrum will speak to the boys and girls next week. Tim and Caroline Carson will be on Children's Church. Don Atchison, Beatrice Glass, and Carol Morrison will be on Christ duty. Then our prayer meeting preceding the gospel meeting at 6:30. And the singer next Sunday night is Jim Ferguson. And I'll be preaching, God willing, at both services. There will be a praise group practice after church, 8 o'clock also, youth fellowship. Now, on Monday the 20th of November, David Crutchley will be coming to hold a training session for all the children's workers here in the church, those who work in Sunday school, those who work in Bible class, those who do children's talks on the rota each Sunday morning, and those who would perhaps like to add their name to that rota in days to come. It's also for Good News Club and every aspect of work amongst the children. And we're doing this because we feel if we're going to teach our children the way that they deserve to be taught, maybe some of us ourselves, including me, need to be taught how we can more effectively teach the children in the church. So keep that in your mind. Monday the 20th, if it includes you, come along to that training night. Would anyone who holds the CEF Mourne area mission box or anyone who gives a donation in lieu of a collection box, would you please bring this in and do so? Give it to Lindsay Farrell before Sunday the 12th. A church meal and fun night will be held on Saturday the 25th of November at 5:30 p.m. Please lift the menu in the foyer, and you'll find if you look around you, you will see one of these sheets outside, and you'll see another sheet outside. They all both include all the information that you're going to need. If you intend to go, fill in the menu, return in an envelope with your money by Sunday, the 19th of November. The cost is £10 per adult, and the children go free. Numbers are limited, and it's on a first-come basis. So if you intend to go, fill that in as soon as possible. Just one other announcement you'll be glad to know. Letitia McDonald's prayer letter is now available. There are a number of them out in the foyer, so take one with you as you leave, and you'll be able to pray more specifically for Letitia. Now, those are all the announcements made subject, as always, to the sovereign will of God. Now, Adam is going to come speak with the boys and girls.
Boys and girls, you see, that's me on. A couple more coming, is there? That's grand. Well, can anyone tell me what date it is today, by any chance? Yeah? The 5th of November. And I'm going to ask a question. What is the first thing that comes to your mind when I say the date, the 5th of November? Maybe you haven't quite learned it in school yet. Well, there's a wee rhyme, remember. Do you know it? Yes, remember the 5th of November. That's the first thing. When I knew I was doing the children's talk today, that's the first thing that came to my mind, and I can guarantee so many others thought the same thing when they heard of the 5th of November. But I don't really know much about that story, so don't be asking me too much about Guy Fawkes afterwards. But it got me thinking about remembering and things that we remember. And I wonder here, can anyone remember anything from they were 4 years old? Yes, Esther? You forgot? Anyone else remember anything from they were four? No? Okay, you've remembered? Preschool, wow, excellent. So you've remembered that from when you were four. Well, I remember when I was four, I got the best Christmas present ever. It's probably my favorite ever Christmas present. And it is this, right? It's a Nintendo Game Boy. And some of you might have a Nintendo Switch. This was way back in the day before Nintendo Switch. I heard a couple of people last night talking about when they were at school, they had an abacus. And that was a long before my time. But this was back when I was 4 years old. This is what we used and what we played with. But I wonder, there was only one person could remember something from when they were four. Does anyone remember anything from when they were 1 year old? No? Anyone? Woody, you remember something? What's your memory from when you were one? I think you made that up, Woody. No, I believe you. Well, when I was one, I didn't really, Esther? You were at the park? Wow, that's amazing. Well, I don't really remember this, but my mum remembers this. And I actually have an outfit here from when I was one, right? And I might try and slim down into it again. But this is from when I was one. Now, I was a big baby. I was 11.4 when I was born. So this is when I was one. I would say there's first years smaller than that these days. But This got me thinking about all the things I remember from when I was four and when I was one and when I was a child. And it got me thinking, is there a Bible verse that talks about remembering? And actually there is. It's found in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 12 and verse 1. Can everyone see that okay? All right? Well, thankfully, I've printed it out bigger here, right? It's found in the Bible in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 1. And it says, remember now thy creator in the days of thy youth. So who is our creator? Yeah. God, yeah. And what are some of the things that God created? Does anyone know? Yeah. Us, yeah. Lila? The animals, yeah. The land, yeah. Plants and trees, Joshua. Adam and Eve, perfect, Jack. The water, yeah. So God created all these things. He created the sun and the moon and the stars and the water. And God created everything. And you know, this Bible verse tells us that it is good to remember God, our Creator, while we are young. And actually, the most important thing that we can remember about God is that He sent His Son Jesus to die for us on the cross, and that when we put our trust in Him, we can have forgiveness for our sins and we can have everlasting life. And you know what? Sometimes when we're young, we think that we have our whole lives ahead of us. And maybe sometimes we actually think we're too young to remember about God, or we're too young to become a Christian, or we're too young to serve God. And that's just not true at all. Can anyone think of a few countries that a missionary would go out to? Brazil. Pele, thank you. Anyone else think of a few countries? Well, you know, sometimes we think that a missionary, that's someone who goes to China, or someone who goes to Brazil, or someone who goes to Africa or America, or down into the Republic of Ireland. But you know what? And we can think that that's maybe something for older folk, but we can be missionaries. In fact, boys and girls, if you're a Christian today, you're a missionary wherever you are. And your mission field is in your school, or in your friend group, or in your sports team, or maybe an after-school club that you go to. That's your mission field. And that, I'm too old to go back to school, or I'm too old to be in your friend group or anything like that. So you have such an amazing, unique opportunity while you're young to reach those people where you are. So you're never too young to be a missionary. It's amazing to remember God, our Creator, in the days of our youth. And it's also amazing to speak to our friends while we're young about God. I remember a time when I was young, I put my trust in God, and that was the best decision that I ever made. And boys and girls, just have a think this morning about what God could do in your life. When you have hopefully your whole life ahead of you, if you put your trust in God now, just imagine the amazing things that God could do through your life while you're young. So it's important that we remember God while we're young. So thanks very much for listening. And we're going to sing our children's chorus now, if you just want to come up to the front. And there's accents to this. And I hope I can remember them. Right, everyone stand up if he's fancy it.
Thank you, Adam. It's another way sometimes if you need a part for your car, you don't know where to get it, there's always somebody that has the part that you need. Do you see if you need anything to do with computers, iPhones, anything at all in the last 50 years, Adam has it. Adam has it, and that's why I call now Adam Mr. Apple. Because when anything goes wrong in my phone, I go to see him. He's the man. Let's turn together to the Word of God, and we're turning to Joshua chapter 1. We're turning to the book of Joshua, Joshua chapter 1. And we're going to read the first 9 verses together in chapter 1. Joshua chapter 1. And just before we read, let's pray together. Father, we ask that as we sit in the comfort of this building today, enjoying fellowship the one with the other, we do pray for the world in which we live, and we see so much chaos, confusion, destruction, not just at home here because of recent floods, but because of ongoing warfare across our world in various places, earthquakes. Father, the list is endless. We believe with all our hearts that you're speaking to this world in which we live at this time. But you're also speaking to all our hearts, reminding us that there is a day coming. Our Father, this world will be no more, and that we need to be ready for the great eternity that is yet to come. And we pray that as we see all the events of the days in which we live, that we'll treat them seriously. We pray for those lands that are war-torn. We think of the Middle East especially. Father, you know about the loss of life. You know about missionaries laboring in these areas. You know about missionaries in other parts of the world trying to get alongside those who are passing through difficult times just now. Would you bless those missionaries? Would you bless every missionary who has been called of God and sent out into the world in which we live? And our Father, would you be with them and assure them at this time that you are going to help them and encourage them in all that they're facing. As we come to your word this morning, Father, we come to pray that you might speak into our hearts. Lord, we thank you that we've not only got a living Christ, but we've got the living Word of God. And as we read it just now, write it upon our hearts. As we meditate upon it, give us grace to change and help us become what you want us to be, we pray, in the Savior's precious name. Amen. Amen. Joshua chapter 1 and verse 1 says, "Now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spake unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, thou and all this people, unto the land which I do give to them, even to the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given unto you, as I said unto Moses, from the wilderness in this Lebanon, even unto the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, and unto the great sea toward the going down of the sun, shall be your coast. There shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. I will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. Be strong, and offer good courage, for unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swore unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest. Amen. God will add his blessing to this reading from his word. This morning and in the winter months that lie ahead, we're going to commence a new series of studies that I'm simply calling Journeying with Joshua. If you have read this book, and I'm sure that the most of you have read it many, many times, you will know that this is not just a great book, but it's also a book that is filled with important lessons for every single one of us. I say that because when we look at Joshua himself, firstly, we see a man that was facing a very, very difficult assignment. We know the story, don't we, about Moses and all that has gone before, but now here's a man who was going to have to lead God's people into Canaan, the land of promise, and that would be no easy task. Of course, in today's world, as far as the work of God is concerned, and Adam has been talking about missionaries, whether you're working at home or whether you're working abroad, there are no easy assignments. Because as God's people, we are engaged in a spiritual battle. And the devil, who is the enemy of our souls, never lets up in this battle. He's always on the move. He's always seeking to destroy and to deter and to discourage the people of God. Whether that comes from within, whether it comes from without, the devil will continue this work, and we need to be aware of the enemy that we face. We need to be awakened from our sleep in these changing times. We need to be alert at all times, and we need to adorn every morning the whole armor of God that he has provided for us, and we need to be prepared for battle. Because you see, Satan will not cease until Jesus comes or Jesus calls us home. Secondly, we see a man who was replacing a great leader. And that's never an easy thing for anyone to have to do, whether in Joshua's day or whether in our own, it's quite natural. There will always be those who will make comparisons between one leader or another. Some people warm to one leader rather than the other. Some will respond to one leader rather than the other. It happens all the time in pastoral ministry when somebody comes to step into the shoes of the man previously. Oh, he's not the man we had. He's not the man I'm looking for. And we begin to draw comparisons between people, and some people, and I've met them in the course of ministry, could have three or four people that come sent of God to pastor their church, and they look beyond the four who have come right back 50 years to a man who is long gone and in the glory. You see, there's a difficulty with that because it's like the Corinthian church in Paul's day. Sometimes God's people are more preoccupied with the messenger than they are with the message that he preaches. Just for a moment, let me put this book into its context and give you a brief overview of where Joshua fits in as far as the whole of Scripture is concerned. Some of us did this when we looked at our Bible studies a way back when I came, but for those who didn't, let me say this by way of introduction, because we need to know where Joshua fits in the overall picture of God working with his people. The first five books of the Bible that you have today is referred to as the Pentateuch. And an overview of those five books would show you how that God began to work and how he would continue that work in the life of his servant Joshua. For example, in the first book, Genesis, we read how that God took a man called Abraham out of the Ur of the Chaldees, And he brought him out of a life of idolatry, and he said to Abraham, I want you to go to a place that I will show you. And he stepped out in faith. He didn't know where he was going. He took God at his word, and he left his previous life, and he stepped out with the promises of God ringing in his soul. When we come to the second book, the book of Exodus, we're introduced to the next link in the chain, or the next man in the development of God's people. And this was a man called Moses. His life was preserved as a little child when there he lay amongst the bulrushes, and then he was brought up in an Egyptian home. And then we read about how in the desert in Midian, one day there was a bush that was burning. It didn't go on fire. And God spoke to Moses, and he said, Moses, I want you to be the man that will lead my people out of their bondage in Israel. Moses put up all the excuses of the day, but God took him and God used him in order to see their people of God brought out of bondage. The third of the books is Leviticus. For many people, very difficult to understand. But what God was doing, God was showing his people how he wanted them to live, and therefore he gave them certain laws, how they would conduct themselves, and to make sure that they lived in a manner that was pleasing to him. The fourth book, Numbers, you'll read of different experiences that God's people had to pass through as they continued on their journey to Canaan. You see, in life itself is a journey. God deals with us in different ways at different stages of our lives. And we need to be ready to say, yes, Lord, I will do, I will go, I will be. The fifth book is, of course, Deuteronomy. And there we can see the final preparations of God's people for their entrance into the land of promise. And then following those five books, there's a section of 12. And those are known as the historical books, and it runs from Joshua to the book of Esther. So whenever you and I come to the book of Joshua for the weeks ahead, what we're simply doing is continuing the history of Israel, and that's a story that had begun by God's servant Moses. We here read, when you come to the book of Joshua, God has not only rescued his people from their bondage, he had been shaping them, he had been molding them. He wanted them to understand what they were going to have to face. And after his disciplines in the wanderings in the wilderness, the old generation passed, and God's people were now ready to enter Canaan. That brings us to the book of Joshua. I like the words of the commentator A.W. Pink. He says this about the book of Joshua. He says, the contents of this book and the lessons which they're designed to teach us are greatly needed by our own generation. I think those words are true wherever we find ourselves today. So as we begin our series this morning, here's the title of our first message, Stepping into Moses' Shoes. Stepping into Moses' Shoes. God's servant Moses has already said his farewell. And he had led these people for so long, but he hadn't led them alone, because Joshua, who is now to be the new leader, had been Moses' assistant or Moses' minister. But now he's stepping into Moses' shoes. And I want to tell you two things about this by way of introduction. I want you to note firstly the credentials of this man. Look at Joshua 1 verse 1. It simply says that after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' assistant. Now, those two words, Moses' assistant, they're probably two words we've read often. And when we've read them, we've stepped into the next verse, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now go you. But if we did that, we would miss a whole chunk of Scripture where God was shaping and molding this man, Joshua, for the task that God had for him as Moses' assistant. Now, Joshua was going to have to face a difficult assignment. He was replacing a great leader, but God had already been preparing him behind the scenes for such a time as this. Joshua was not an afterthought. It wasn't as if the camp were crying, "Moses, my servant is dead, now go you." Why you? Because you're the best at this, Joshua. You're the only man that has stepped forward. You're the man, Joshua, that people like better than anybody else. Nothing to do with that. God selected Joshua. And before God ever sent Joshua forth into the work of leading his people, God prepared the man for the task in hand. And when you and I look at Joshua's credentials, you begin to understand if there was anybody in the camp who was cut out for this task of leadership, it was God's servant Joshua. Why do I say that? Well, I'm going to give you this morning seven characteristics. Well, I'll not do it all in the one morning. But seven unique experiences that Joshua came through as Moses' assistant. You see, whenever God has a work to do, God has a man in the background already preparing him, and he will prepare him adequately for the task in hand. I've been long enough doing this in church life where, you know, somebody comes, they pastor a church for a number of years, and then they're moving on, and the people think the church will fall apart. Not a bit of it, because God has already been preparing a man in the background to step into the breach. It happens all the time. It has happened down through the centuries. Whatever God has a work to do, whether it's in the mission field, whether it's in ministry at home, God, unknown to us, is already preparing a person, a man or a woman, for the task. And it took time for God to prepare this man, to mold him. And I want you to come with me and look at these seven unique experiences. Number one, for Joshua, there was the importance of prayer. The importance of prayer. Look for a moment, if you want, to turn back to Exodus 17, to verse 8 and 9. But I'll read it for you, for it says this. Now Amalek came and fought with Israel in Rephidim. And Moses said to Joshua, "Choose us out some men and go out fight with Amalek tomorrow. I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand." This story is well known to many of us, so I'll be brief. The Amalekites were the enemies of Israel. They had often attacked God's people of old, and Moses told Joshua on this occasion to go and choose out some suitable men and then to go out and to engage in battle with the Amalekites. Moses, who by now was in his 80s, he went up a hill in order to pray. And Joshua went down into the valley below in order to fight and to take charge of the army. And the story tells us that there were times when Israel was winning and there were times when the Amalekites were winning. And the Amalekites were winning at every time. Moses dropped his hands with tiredness. When he held his hands up to God, God heard the man. God had also molded this man. And when he prayed, God moved and God helped his people down in the valley below. Whenever he dropped his hands, the Amalekites got the upper hand. So what happened? Aaron and Hur got alongside Moses and they held up his hands. And they did so as Joshua fought in the valley and until Israel claimed the victory. I want to say this morning as your pastor. I'm so thankful for those behind the scenes who hold up my hands, who take time daily to pray, help the pastor, Lord, today. Fill him with the Spirit of God today, Lord. I'm grateful for those who hold up the hands of the man in the pulpit. But you know, as far as Joshua was concerned, there were many significant things that he would learn from all that happened that day. But there was one thing for Joshua that was vitally important. He learned that day that real power is not found in the sword. Real power is found on your knees before God. He gained the victory in the valley, but the victory was fought on the mountaintop with a man in his 80s holding up his hand, and when he got tired, brought them down. And then they get two men to come alongside him, Aaron, Hur. They hold his hands up, and as he prayed and interceded with God, the victory was gained down in the valley. Do you know the first thing that Jonah learned that day was his utter dependence on God. His utter dependence on God. And not only that, but he understood that prayer was of the utmost importance in his life and in the life of all of those that God calls into leadership. Child of God, this is not just for leaders. This is for all of us as Christians. How many of us go out every morning without ever asking for the help of God and the direction of God and the presence of God in all that we do? How many of us get up and send our children out to school, get on the bus there quickly or you'll miss it, without even commending them to the Lord in prayer? How many of us just get up and go through every single day and we don't take time to pray? Joshua realized if he was going to be successful as a leader of this people, he had to realize his utter dependence upon God. I have to say today that this is a great lesson, but I think it's a great lesson that so many churches have quickly forgotten about. You say, Pastor, why do you say that? Well, you talk to those involved in Christian ministry. So many prayer meetings in local churches are languishing, declining in number. Believers no desire to pray. Churches who no longer set aside special seasons of prayer to seek God's face and guidance. The list goes on. And you know why? One reason is because today we've got so much and we're so comfortable we don't need God. That's it. We're so comfortable we don't have to ask God for anything. We just decide we want it, we go and get it. We never have to say, Lord, will you help me? Lord, will you provide for me? Lord, will you enable me? Lord, will you empower me? We just live so often our Christian lives without God. That's the same for the man in the pulpit as it is for the person in the pew. And if today we were to gauge the spiritual temperature in this fellowship by the prayer meeting in this local church, would it be high, middle, or down low? Because that's how you gauge the spiritual temperature in any church. Joshua learned an important lesson that day, and it was the importance of prayer. Here's the second thing. For Joshua, there was the importance of vision. Because the next time We read of Joshua's developing leadership credentials. It's found in Exodus 24:13, and it says this. So Moses arose with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up to the mountain of God. This, of course, is an occasion in Exodus 24. And Joshua goes up with Moses right up onto the top of the mountain, and he's with Moses to meet with God. And it was there that the cloud covered Mount Sinai in a very special way, and he was given a vision of God. There's no doubt that that experience had made a lasting impression in Joshua. It gave him a sense of God's glory. It gave him a sense of God's holiness. It gave him a sense of God's absolute power and authority. Do you know what? That's something I need afresh this morning. Maybe that's what I need more than anything else. This man standing on the verge of a great work. He knew it was going to be difficult. He had already seen these people in action under the leadership of Moses. That would have concerned him. He'd watched Moses on different occasions trying to cope with difficulty, discouragement, as the people vented their anger on him and blamed him for their portion. And Joshua knew he was embarking on a great task. But he knew he could depend on a great God. A great God. That day on the mountaintop on Mount Sinai, Joshua got a vision of the God that he would soon serve. It's interesting. There were others in Scripture who, like Joshua, were refreshed and helped by such a vision of God. What about Isaiah in Isaiah 6? We often refer to this, don't we? And you remember how it all begins? In the days that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and what? His glory filled the temple. And as Isaiah thought about God and looked at God, he realized that in the light of God's holiness, he saw himself. Woe is me, I'm a sinner. And that impacted this man's life and this man's ministry. You can think of Peter, James, and John. We'll be thinking about them tonight. Mark 9:2-8, how that they were given a similar experience on the Mount of Transfiguration when they got a glimpse, just a glimpse, of Christ's future glory. It transformed their lives, for both Peter and John speak about it in their epistles. You could think of the Apostle Paul. In 2 Corinthians 12, he had such an experience in the presence of God, he couldn't even speak about it. And then you have the Apostle John in Revelation 1. There on the Isle of Patmos, he saw Christ and he fell at his feet as if he were dead. You and I are living in days today of great confusion. Much counterfeit Christianity right across our world and even nearer home. And I get articles all the time sent to me in the post, and I read about them, and I hear people talking about a vision of God, and I talk about the Spirit of God moving, and I read of people rolling about the floor in laughter and falling with a touch of a man's hand, and I see them lying, laughing with their feet in the air like hyenas. I read the Bible, I see those who come into contact with God falling at his feet. Falling at his feet. Overcome by God's holiness. Understanding his majesty. Understanding their own unworthiness. And if you and I were to get a vision of God today, brother or sister in Christ, and I would that I would, and you too, I'll tell you what it'll do. It'll bring us to our knees in humility. It will bring us to our knees at home in repentance for all our sin, open sin, secret sins. You can't stand in the presence of a thrice holy God and catch something of his holiness without sensing your own heart. And it will bring us out to meetings like this in true worship, where I'm not worrying too much about who's out and who's not out, or how they're out or who's not coming out. I just want to come out and meet with God. I want to go home and know that when I came out, God was there. And the presence of God was real. And that it humbled me and sent me home, longing for a closer walk with God. The importance of prayer, the importance of vision. For Joshua, there was the importance of devotion. Listen to these words, I'll be brief. Exodus 33:11. So the Lord spoke to Moses face to face, as a man speaks to his friend. They were in the tabernacle when the pillar of cloud rested upon the tent. And it says this, he, that is Moses, would return to the camp. But his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, did not depart from the tabernacle. Now, Joshua wasn't as privileged as Moses was to speak face to face with God. Nevertheless, Joshua was so overcome with God's presence, he would not leave the tabernacle. He was devoted to God. He was devoted to God. You know, there's another lovely picture of devotion in the New Testament, where you and I read of a lady called Mary sitting at the feet of Jesus. Martha, her sister, was busy around the house, tidying up, making this, doing things that had to be done. Mary sat at the feet of Jesus and listened to his word. And when Martha complained, Mary sat on, and Jesus said, look, Martha, you're cumbered about many things, but Mary has chosen the better part. Devoted to Jesus. You see, no matter who we are, no matter what work we're engaged in, without hearts of passion and love for Jesus, without lives devoted to him, we'll see very little accomplished. Let me tell you a story, and with this I'll finish. I remember learning this story of devotion very vividly on one occasion on a trip with the Slavic to the Republic of Moldova. These people had prayed that within a 10-year period, God would help them to establish 1,000 new churches. The problem was God heard and answered their prayer. And people were getting saved, not in ones or twos, sometimes in tens and twenties, and they were meeting together in villages, and they had no building. They had no roof over their head. They sat on the grass. And I remember going to this church meeting with a group of believers in one of the villages. They'd been there for 2 years. No building to meet in. Winter and summer they met in the open air in a space between two houses. I got the short straw, for I was there during sub-zero temperatures. And there I was sitting with this group of people who longed to hear the word of God. And it began to snow. And the snow trickled down, and I thought, we're in for a soaking. One of the men went over to the side of the house, and he pulled out a bit of old plastic covering. And he got a man there, and a man there, and a man here, and a man there, and they lifted it up, and they held it. Like Moses' hands were held up in the battle with the Amalekites. And there we sit, and the only reason they covered it wasn't because of the snow. They wanted to worship, and they wanted that their Bibles would be dry as they listened to the Word of God. That's a picture of devotion. In Northern Ireland, we have some of the most beautiful buildings. Some buildings going up now over £1 million and some far more. With all the latest technology at our fingertips. And sadly, half of those buildings, or maybe more, are sitting half empty. Is it because the music's not good? No. Is it because the technology's not good? No. Is it because they don't have a roof over their head? No. Then why is it? Because they've left their first love. Because they've left their first love. Beloved, I'm grateful. Grateful that every meeting, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, that there are those who are out at the meetings encouraging my soul no end. It's not about me. It's about Jesus. It's not about the building. It's about the message. And it will never be about us. But it'll always be about Him. Joshua had to learn so many important lessons. 7 unique characteristics in this man's life before he could ever go into the ministry. The importance of prayer, the importance of vision, and the importance of devotion. We'll pick it up again, God willing, next week. Let's bow in prayer. Father, we thank you for these men and women that we read of in the scriptures. Joshua, stepping into big shoes, but he would do so with the assurance that God was with him. Mary, who chose the better part, sitting at the feet of Jesus. Oh, today we pray, as we learn lessons from those of old, that the pages of Scripture will not only be refreshing, but they will burn in our hearts, so that at the end of the day we will see something of the God whom we serve and something of the God that we worship this morning. Father, help us, we sincerely and earnestly pray, for we so much long not only to be filled with the Spirit and with power, but we long that the very glory of God might fill this place. We ask it for Christ's sake and for His glory. Amen. Amen. Let's sing together a lovely hymn. Jesus, Master, whose I am, purchased thine alone to be, by thy blood, O spotless Lamb, shed so willingly for me. Let's stand and sing together. Jesus, Master, whom I serve. What dimensions, our Father, that opens up for all of us today who know and love the Savior. Help us to love him more. Help us to serve him better. Help us to be more like him in every aspect of our journey home. Bless those who leave us now. Take them to their homes in safety, and bless those of us who wait around the Lord's table to remember him. We ask it all in the Savior's precious and worthy name. Amen. Amen.